Hey everybody, and welcome to the latest episode of Watch, Read, Listen. I am your host, David Watson. Sitting across from me is, as always, is my co-host,
Dwayne Watson.
And this is going to be our last in our creator month, and we'll get into that here in just a second. But Dwayne, first, what have you been watch, reading, and or listening to?
Well, since the last podcast, the main thing that we've had, I've been reading stuff by William Browning Spencer, so that's pretty much been almost all that I've done, apart from the normal podcasts, most of which I've mentioned before.
Yeah.
While we were out of town, we went to Stonewall to visit Jen's dad, and while we were there, we watched a couple of really terrible Jerry Lewis movies, and it was kind of a weird experience. I used to love Martin and Lewis movies that I, you know, they're fun, they're goofy.
They are.
You know, Jerry Lewis is...
I haven't watched one since I was a kid, but yeah, no, like I remember always having a lot of fun with them.
Yeah, they're usually pretty good. These were just Jerry Lewis, and it was kind of interesting to see just how like casually racist and sexist they were. Like it was just like a normal everyday sort of thing. There's even one movie where there's a guy whose name is Fong, and he is supposed to be Chinese and says a lot of stuff from Confucius.
Okay.
And also is into Kabuki, which is Japanese, and I'm pretty sure Fong is not Chinese.
Right.
And so it's like they didn't really even know like what part of Asia they were talking about. They're just like, he's generically Asian. He has the Chinese mustache, and he talks with the Chinese accent. The accent he's doing is that fake Chinese accent. It's not a Japanese accent. And so it was just really funny just to see how just kind of terrible it was just on that level. Then, of course, the sexist part of it, there was a whole movie. The one with the casual racism is actually called The Big Mouth, and it actually has a young George Takei in it. It's like it was made right in between when a couple of the seasons of Star Trek.
Okay.
And I looked at it, and I was like, that looks like George Takei, and I had to go look it up, and apparently it was. He was uncredited, and then he gets thrown, he's working for this Fong guy, and he gets thrown into a boiling pot of water for their laundry service or whatever. The other one was called Three on the Couch, and it actually had Janet Leigh in it from, most people know from Psycho nowadays. And it was just, again, just like kind of casual sexism, this whole idea that, you know, for women, these three women in this movie they have like a bunch of anxiety, and it's all about guys. So it basically completely, you know, fails the Bechdel test and all that sort of stuff.
A lot of things, actually.
A lot of things do. But in this case, it was just because it's just completely like, that's all it is. It's about their relationships with men. And if they, in order to get healed psychologically, they have to like get you know that they're pretty and okay, and you know, and so that's
interesting.
So it was kind of a weird sort of thing to see that, because we were just sitting there watching, you know, on this channel, whatever, it was because he has cable, watching whatever was on there, and it was just generally kind of terrible. So yeah, really, that's kind of it. It was a really odd week, apart from the fact that we both saw Batman versus Superman, which we'll talk about on the next episode, our special episode. So
yeah,
we'll get to that later.
You guys are going to be, it's going to be cool for everybody. You're going to get two episodes this week. I guess I'm looking for what we didn't drop an episode in last week. I know. Besides that, I don't really, my next thing that I did was I don't do a full, like, I'm not sure other people do this or not. Like the whole, I don't know if anybody actually does the sit-through binge watch when a new Netflix show drops. I'm sure it's been done.
Well, I obviously don't, because I still haven't seen things.
I personally don't. I usually break it up over, you know, over like I over a few days. In this case, actually, I did over 3 days. It dropped on the 18th of March. Was season 2 of Daredevil, and I watched it over 3 days. I won't go too in depth about it, 'cause Dwayne still has not watched season 1 yet.
Nope.
Which is really funny that I finished season 2 of Daredevil and I still really haven't finished Jessica Jones yet.
Right.
Which is not to talk about the quality of Jessica Jones. I'm just a huge Daredevil fan, so
right.
It was kind of given. Like, I think Jessica Jones is a quality,
yeah,
one of the best shows that Marvel's produced. Daredevil, to me, still... I thought it was amazing. This has got... everybody knows about the hallway scene in season one. There's a fight at the end of episode two. Daredevil fights these guys, and it's kind of set up to look like one long continuous shot. I've heard backs and forth because I've heard people say like, "Oh no, I can see where the edits are," but then like I think the Marvel team hasn't really copped to it. They say they keep saying it's one continuous shot, and it's really amazing. This has a couple of fight scenes throughout the season, one involving the Punisher and one involving Daredevil, both of which are almost top that hallway scene. The one with Daredevil involves him fighting down a stairwell as he's like descending down it.
Okay.
It's pretty amazing. That it's one of those things you don't get, you don't really kind of like, it doesn't kind of leave your head automatically. This season actually develops the characters even better. I heard a lot of complaints about, and I didn't really bother me too much, but I heard complaints about about Foggy and Karen and their characters kind of being relegated to not doing a whole lot in season one. I still liked them. I dug their characters. I think they have more of an impact this season than they did last season. And then John Bernthal as the Punisher is amazing. He really embodies that character.
That's good to know.
In a really good way too. He's a hard character to play because it's hard to humanize that character. That's something that I think that they've always struggled with in terms of trying to make the movies and everything, is that it's hard to make that character human, because essentially all he is he's basically Dexter before there was Dexter. He's a serial killer who kills other people. You know, like, I think he just kills bad guys. You know, that's all Frank Castle really is. If you want to boil him down to like a quick stereotype, that's all he does.
Yeah. Just right.
He really does a really good job of humanizing him and really getting you to see. It's scary in that it almost gives you an idea of what's going on, and you don't agree with his methods, but you see where he's coming from and why he does things the way that he does.
Right.
And to keep away from the spoilers, there's a surprise that even I didn't know about when I was watching it. And luckily it was one of those things that didn't get spoiled for me. I don't really care about spoilers at all, but, it didn't get, I had no heard, see nobody mention of it when I got to this, to what happens, I think in the eighth or ninth episode. It was really quite surprising, in a good way. So, yeah, that's pretty much it for.
All right.
For me. I watched 12 episodes or 13 episodes of Daredevil. Which is a lot to kind of digest at one time.
Yeah, so. That's a very...
like you said, we watched Batman v Superman. I've seen it twice now, but we'll talk about that when we get to the special edition.
All right, cool.
So our creator this month, our last creator of the month is somebody that not a lot of people have heard about. In fact, I would almost sit there and say, I will not be surprised if this is one of our least listened to episodes, because it involves somebody that not, I'm hoping that people maybe will go out and actually like take our recommendations and read his work.
Yeah.
Because I think that's part of the idea of doing this episode is exposing more people to his work.
Right.
And that's William Browning Spencer.
Yeah. So, I guess as far as how we found out about him, you know, the funny thing is when I'm thinking about, why did I pick up Zod Wallop, which is the first book that we read?
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of about why I picked it up, and I don't actually know. Like, I'm thinking it had something to do with the cover of the paperback.
Yes.
Which has a almost the artwork on those 90s paperbacks, because they're different now if you get the ebook versions, which we'll talk about later. The artwork's not the same as those paperbacks. It reminded me a lot of kind of Dave McKean.
Yeah, it's got that very like painted photo collage.
Yeah, the combination mixed very media.
Mixed media, but very strange. Like, it's one of those things that with Dave McKean's work too. Yeah, you're trying to figure out what's the relation to.
Yeah, there's a lot going on.
There's a lot going on in it that you can look at.
And also with this one, this is going to sound really strange, but I think a lot of it had to do with, when it comes to books, I'm weirdly tactile. I mean, people talk about that as the reason why they buy like books because they like the feel of a book in their hand. But when I say that I like the feel of the material that the book was made out of, it wasn't the normal slick paperback, the kind of cheapy paperback material that you get. It has a different feel to it, almost like a texture, but not exactly a texture.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's a weird thing.
No. It makes perfect sense to me. I actually get it.
But I'm thinking that, let's see, I would have been in college at the time. So this is in relatively soon after it came out. So this is 1996, 97. And I think I picked it up in Hastings, which is a chain of bookstores and video stores that are often in college towns or small towns. There's one near us in Conroe. This would have been in Brownwood, Texas.
Yes.
And I, a lot of times in Brownwood of all places, there's not a whole lot to do. It's pretty much go to Walmart, go to Whataburger. Those two places are open 24 hours. And as long as it's open, go to Hastings, because where else are you going to go? I mean, there's just not much going on.
Yeah, no.
And so, I used to go there and peruse the bookshelves and look at things, and I just picked it up because I thought it was interesting and read it. And then I think I passed my copy on to you.
Yes.
And then you read it. And that's how we found out about William Browning Spencer.
Yeah. Yeah. I was visiting you in Austin.
Yeah.
And I had, was telling you about a screenplay idea that I had that I had already started kind of writing or were fleshing out ideas. And you said that it bore a similarity in concept to this book.
Yeah.
It's even funnier to realize that they are nothing alike whatsoever. Just they have a central concept that's very similar to one another.
Yeah.
And then you're like, oh, you should read this for that reason.
Yeah. It's the idea, if you were to boil down the idea to like its most simplest and in a way generic.
If you were to sit there and like a log line.
Yeah.
If you were to sit there, if my script to the book, if you were to give them like a log line description, they are almost very similar.
Yeah.
Except that one involves a screenplay, the other involves a children's book.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's really the core difference. But yeah, that was the first day I read it. And I think I read that one twice.
Mm-hmm.
I want to say. And then even Christina's read it, actually. So, but she really loved it. She actually hasn't read any of his other books, but she's read that one.
Okay, cool.
And she's a huge fan of that one. She loves that book.
Yeah, I wish I had her maybe write down some idea, some thoughts or something like that.
If she has some. We might have to have her do something like maybe later on the website if she actually sit down and write something down or something about it. But yeah, whatever. She's a huge fan of that book, though.
So we're going to kind of go through the books in publication order just to kind of keep everything organized to a certain extent. But one of the things that as we go through here that I'm hoping people see is there's a lot of common threads. And what's kind of funny about it is as I've gone back and looked at our past episodes this month, they're very connected thematically in a way that I didn't anticipate when we first, because when we first came up with this idea of March being a creator's month, it was like, David was like, I have two creators in mind that I want to do. Who do you want to do? And I named two people and that was it.
Yeah.
Like I didn't sit down and like plan out any sort of theme.
Yeah.
But as I think about it, I'm starting to see like a bit of a theme running through at least Terry Gilliam, Neil Gaiman, and William Browning Spencer.
Yeah.
Sam Raimi, it's not quite as strong. But I think it's, you could, if you wanted to stretch it that direction, you could definitely
do
that. So the funny thing about William Browning Spencer as an author is we don't have a whole lot of like background information.
No.
If I remember correctly, I believe he was from Virginia, moved to Austin And if he's not from Virginia, I apologize.
It's something like that, though. You're pretty close.
But he wasn't from Austin. He moved to Austin, Texas. And
to my knowledge, he still lives there.
Yeah, and as far as I know, he still lives there. He doesn't put out a whole lot of material. He's got a few short stories that are reprinted in some magazines relatively recently, as recently as 2013. His last collection of short stories came out in 2006, 2007.
Yeah, 2006. He did have a short story that was published in Best of Horror in 2008.
Right, and I had a couple. There's a couple of horror anthologies that are now, or not horror anthologies. A couple of fantasy science fiction magazines. One's Lightspeed, and the other one Clark's World, that are available also in ebook format on Amazon. And they have two of his short stories that aren't in Return to Count Electric at all. I double checked to make sure.
Oh, okay. That's cool.
So they're actually new ones, and I'll have to get those to you so you can read those. So there's not a whole lot of, he hasn't had a whole lot of output, which is kind of funny because if you look at his stories overall, it kind of makes sense. Like, it would make sense that he's not like constantly putting things out, that these are more works that take more time. You put almost like they're more personal that way. Not to say that somebody like Neil Gaiman or Stephen King isn't writing personal fiction.
Well, it's strange too, though, actually, because really, in truth, I think there's only he's only had four novels, and they're all within an eight. He did it. They have an 8-year publication span.
Yeah, these are all in the '90s.
So 1990 was when his first novel, Maybe I'll Call Anna, came out, and which we haven't read.
Yeah, I mentioned this in the announcement video that maybe I'll, by the time I found out about William Browning Spencer, Maybe I'll Call Anna was already out of print. And at this time, finding out of print books was not really easy. It was pretty difficult in the 90s. You couldn't just go to Amazon and find somebody who was selling it and then just buy it.
Yeah, yeah. And if you find it, I think if you find it on Amazon now and a used seller, it's not cheap.
Yeah, which is what's awesome about it now is that it's available as an ebook, as I mentioned already, and I've gone ahead and bought it. I just didn't get around to reading it yet.
Yeah.
So at some point I'll give some thoughts about Maybe I'll Call Anna. And so that's 1990, and then in 1993 Spencer publishes The Return of Count Electric and Other Stories.
Right.
And so this is a short story collection. One of the best parts of this, I think, is the introduction, because his introduction is really about literary criticism.
Yeah.
And specifically about the short story. I don't know if you had a chance to reread it or
not. No, I didn't have a chance to reread it, but now that you're talking about it, I was like, oh yeah, I remember that, because I remember really, really liking, I liked what he talked about in terms of the short story structure.
Yeah.
And how it really is, I think he almost said it's almost, people view short stories almost as being, they think of them as being easier, but they're actually probably a tad harder. You have to put a little bit more into them.
Well, novels are a sort of thing that they take shape in the growing, and you can almost like write yourself out of any problems that you encounter.
Yeah.
Whereas a short story, if it goes wrong, like it's you can't write out of that. There's no way.
Yeah.
And you
almost have to do like a page one rewrite if you're trying to, if something just goes thematically wrong, you have to, it's like going back to the drawing board. At least that's how it's been for me too. And whenever I've tried to write any kind of short stories, I remember one that I wrote having Christina kind of go like, why did you, this, like, you could tell you, she goes, I could tell you wrote this in two different settings. And that's the really interesting thing about being a good short story writer, is that I think it's something kind of he mentions, that it's like, if you're not careful, you know, your tones can go out of place really quickly, and that's hard to come back from.
Yeah, and that actually goes back to something that Edgar Allan Poe talked about a long time ago, because we're talking about like the 1830s, 1840s, and he said that it's okay. I paused. He said that the short story should have a single dominant impression that it should give you. Whatever you're going for, that tone and the feeling, the emotion inspired in the audience should be like one thing. It shouldn't be trying to do like a whole bunch of stuff.
Yeah.
And so I think that Spencer certainly accomplishes that. But the other thing that he really talks about is why short stories, and this of course is again talking about the 1990s, why short stories were so unpopular. That the short story used to be a popular format. And by the 90s, short stories were now relegated to literature collections that rarely ever even.
Yeah, it used to be you could get a lot of work. I think from the 20s. Mm-hmm. Well, I think actually we'll go through for the back from Poe probably to 60s and 70s. I mean, yeah. Short stories were you know most magazines carried them in some fashion or another, so you could get. It was an easier route for a lot of people to get published in because they could get published in any magazine. It didn't have to be a collection of...
You had like short stories running in I don't know, specifically in Ladies' Home Journal, but in that sort of magazine. Like you'd have a short story by somebody. The New Yorker still runs short stories.
You go so far as to say, like, what's funny is that as is regarded, Playboy was actually good at like launching people's
careers.
That's
actually
true.
Yeah,
they would take chances on authors mm-hmm. that other publishers wouldn't.
Yeah,
and so there's authors who got careers based off of being able to get published in those places. So. Yeah.
And so one of the things he says basically is, I'm going to pause for a second there because if you all are hearing dogs bark, I apologize. My door is open. My cats are outside, and they like to antagonize the dogs in the backyard. Next door to us. So I'm going to close the door.
All right. Everybody's inside.
All right. So talking about short stories again, that basically by the 90s, he says that the short story as a medium had become not about readers, but about writers. What writers were going for when they wrote short stories was they were writing them for other writers. They wanted appreciation. From writers. And so you'd have, you know, things like extended metaphors that are really deep and they turns of phrase and like descriptions. And I actually kind of have a little bit of experience with this because I think it's still the same way. When I first started my master's program, I started as an MFA in creative writing. And the sort of work that a lot of the students were really putting out was that kind of like realistic fiction, just, you know, it could be just somebody like sitting around, like his example that he uses, somebody making a bologna sandwich or going out to pick up the newspaper or something like that.
Because I think, and that's one of the things that like could be, almost like they became self-indulgent pieces for writers. I see. That's what. At least that was my takeaway. I think I remember from that. It's like, you can get self-indulgent because if you're not writing for readers and you're writing for writers and then you're trying to impress them, that can be.
Oh, here's the example that he uses. This is a bit, and I'll give you a little bit of an idea of where he's coming from. He says that what threatens the well-being of the short story, what may indeed lead to its ultimate demise, except as a kind of arcane craft. Is the dominance of short fiction as extended metaphor, fine writing for the sake of fine writing, critical disparagement of plot, and a general disregard for the reader's right to some narrative movement. When the heroine of the story wraps a bologna sandwich in cellophane before falling asleep on the sofa, the reader has the right to demand why 2,000 words are exhausted for that purpose. And I want to say, like, really, for me, you know, a big part of my literary my literary theory, my literary ideas really come from reading fiction that is heavily dependent on plot. Science fiction and fantasy, of course, being in horror, being like, if something doesn't happen in the story, then you have no story. And and so many times you see people really just talking about how the plot, they're like, well, we don't care about plot. What we want is character development. And you see the same thing in movies too. I even have a book on my shelf called Writing the Character-Centered Screenplay, because that's a big, if you could talk to Hollywood people, they're like, no, they care about character. They just care about, do you have a character that you can care for? And that might be true. I believe character matters, but I think you still have to have things that happen, and the things that happen still have to hang together.
I think it's cool, because the majority of the critics that I whose work I appreciate, they actually kind of focus on both. They want character and plot. Like, they want both to be able to intermingle with one another.
Right.
That your plot should be able to develop based off of your character's actions, and you're developing your character through those actions as well.
Right.
It should kind of be a cohesion as you're moving along.
Yeah, and I think that, so for the most part, I think completely, this collection of short stories really does attempt to do that. He, of course, says, that maybe he hasn't, he's not completely successful in that. But for the, you know, all these stories, it's about something that for the most part, something happens, and that something happening is, you know, the important part of it. So a couple of the stories that kind of I find interesting, of course, we have the title story, The Return of Count Electric.
That's always the one that stuck with me for like out of the, there's the one, and there's one, the Stephen King one that two I have always appreciated. Count Electric, I think, is actually one of the most disturbing short stories I've ever read.
Yeah, yeah. It kind of fits to me in, it's disturbing in the same way that something like Seven is disturbing.
Yes.
And that's as far as I'm going to go with it. I'm just going to say, you know, and you can kind of, if you want some sort of feeling for what we're talking about here in terms of range, you know, literary range, Spencer is capable of writing something that is as disturbing as Seven.
It's a good idea.
The different permutations of that.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But then also, of course, talking about just regular mundane sort of things. One of the stories is about a wedding photographer, and I mean, there's nothing paranormal or supernatural or horror driven or anything about the story. It's real people. So he can write that realistic fiction. What kind of holds together for a lot of his stories, and we can talk about this as we go through each of these, you'll see how it works out, is the unreliable narrator, that you're not always 100% sure you trust the person you're getting your information from.
Yeah, yeah. And that's it's interesting in the way he applies that when we get into the novels, too,
because
he's not usually writing in first person.
No,
and that's what's really kind of brilliant about the way he writes.
Yeah, I want to say the wedding photographer, that one actually, The Wedding Photographer in Crisis is the name of the story, actually is written in first person point of view. But when he describes things, you can tell from the way this first person narrator is describing something that what he's talking about is not exactly what is happening, not in the literal sense. It's literally what he's talking about is what's happening. It's in more in the interpretive sense.
Yeah,
in his interpretation of things, that's not the way a normal person would interpret.
Yeah,
things.
There's embellishments to the way the events that are occurring. I think there's embellishments that he's adding to them.
Yeah,
yeah.
And
yeah.
He downplays,
almost exaggerating a lot. Or downplaying things. Yeah,
yeah. In this case, he usually, like I say, he downplays kind of what's going on, and it gives you that sense of somebody who really is like fundamentally disturbed.
Yes.
And this is the other part of it, is a lot of these stories.
That one's been a long time since I've read it, but I remember that.
And this isn't the only story in this collection that is along the same lines, but you can tell that there's a lot of his stories deal with people who are disturbed because, or at least in part, because of a relationship that has gone wrong.
Yes.
Or because of jobs that have gone wrong, or some combination thereof. Pretty much like 100% of the time, there's a bad relationship and something professional that just isn't working out.
Right.
And that theme that you see running through there, what I find fascinating both about these short stories and the novels is just how relatable that really is.
Yeah, 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 yeah. That's the best thing you can, like, that I think of him as a writer too, and is that he's able to, sorry. He's able to create these very human characters that you can identify with, and he's still throwing them into these fantastical situations. Mm-hmm. And that's an interesting like thing for him to try to like thread, because he really is kind of like approaching this, and he's making these characters who are very flawed human beings that you can identify with from the get-go.
Right.
Even if you're not going through those exact same circumstances, he very much is able to come to impart the feelings.
Yes.
So it helps you as the reader, when these fantastical things are going on, keep identifying with them.
Yeah.
Instead of having a disconnect, I think, is how I've always looked at it with his writing.
Yeah, I find myself always like brought into the fantastical things by the way he's subtly like layers it in.
Yes.
So that you, in some cases he might just jump out and just say it, but a lot of the time he's like subtly like building it, and then by the time you're you know, halfway or three quarters of the way through the novel, you're completely in it. And there's just no, like, you're just accepting this is what's going on.
Yeah, yeah.
Even if in the back of your mind, maybe you're sometimes questioning it. Because, again, we are talking about narrators who are usually unreliable for various reasons.
Right. And that's, yeah, that's kind of what is really cool, especially if, I don't know if we want to jump into Resume with Monsters first.
Yeah, that's a good transition.
But with Resume with Monsters, one of the key things that happens in the novel, and it's a novel broken up into three parts, is that there's a point in the story where you are pretty much, I almost get the feeling that he doesn't want you to think that he's reliable whatsoever, and that what yeah. you're seeing isn't necessarily what's going on and occurring.
Yes.
So, Resume with Monsters, that would be his 1995. He actually released two books in 1995.
This is his second novel.
And kind of what's a general overview of what?
So
how would you?
Well, I mean, so let's talk about
how would we tell this to the layman who's listening to this.
So the main character is Philip Keenan, and in when the story opens, he's working as a typesetter for Ralph's One Day Resumes, and he's terribly unhappy with this job and everything with, and you can tell from the way he talks about the coworkers and the boss and all of the different things he has to kind of put up with, and even the clientele, the way he talks about like these people who are making these resumes. This is, you know, before the days of ubiquitous computers, and so you couldn't just, you know, pull up Microsoft Word and make a resume automatically. People actually had to typeset these things and print them out and all that sort of stuff. Or the business cards, where he just talks about how like all these retired guys want, you know, like almost the same type of business card, or why, and why would anybody want like a piece of paper with your information on it?
Right.
So you can tell that Keenan is very like, just, he just thinks this is the dumbest thing in the world. Now the reason why Keenan is in this, by the way, this novel takes place in Austin, and having lived there, it's kind of cool to see, because he mentions streets names and things like that, and I'm like, oh, I know what that is. But the reason he's in Austin is because he followed his ex-girlfriend Amelia to Austin. She left to get away from him, and he followed her because he's convinced that she left because of the terrible things that happened at their former employer, Micromeg.
Yes.
which is like somewhere outside of Washington, D.C., in the Virginia area.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Of Washington, D.C. So that's what it is. He's gone. He's come back to Austin. He's got this really terrible relationship with Amelia because she's convinced that he went crazy and knocked her out and put her on a mail cart. And that's what it is. I mean, he's trying to get her back. But in the background, or when I say in the background, it's in the foreground for him, he's got this book he's been working on called The Despicable Quest. So he's a writer. That's the first part of it. Like he's, and it's very important. A lot of the people in these three novels, Resume with Monsters, Zod Wallop, and Irrational Fears, there is that the literature part of it is very important.
Yeah, yeah. All of his main characters are either... Actually, it's kind of funny because he doesn't just do the failed writer part, because he does. Yeah, they're all creative.
Well, in Zod Wallop, he's not even a failed writer, but we'll talk about that.
Yeah,
more.
He's creative.
He's a successful writer.
There's creative types. Yeah.
Yeah, they're definitely creative types. Irrational Fears is a literature professor, but you have the, you know, this failed writer. He's got this gigantic book that just keeps growing and growing and growing, and he's obsessed with Lovecraft, H.P. Lovecraft, and so this book is really like the mythos, the Cthulhu mythos monsters, Cthulhu and Yog-Sothoth and all of that stuff, Nyarlathotep, which I can never say correctly. All of those things from Lovecraft are in this novel. Like that's what they are.
Yeah.
Now whether or not they're really there or not, it's kind of up to you to decide. There's, you know, reasons why you might think, cause again, he's an unreliable narrator.
Right.
So you're not 100%
of his psychosis. This could be actually happening to him because I think he recalls a story that of an incident, when he was a teenager.
Yes.
At the pool. It was the first time that he touched.
Yeah. His dad used to, read him Lovecraft when he was a kid. And,
because they even points out that that was a strange thing to do to a kid.
Yeah, that normally that wouldn't be the sort of thing. And the reason why I'm saying this is no sort of, this isn't a spoiler at all. This is literally on the first page. It says, Philip parked, unbuckled the seatbelt, exhaled, work. It could be worse. It had been. This was a safe harbor. So far, he had seen no signs of Cthulhu or Yog-Sothoth or his dread messenger, Nyarlathotep. So it's like right there. That's page one.
Yeah, we're not giving anything away with
he's
that.
Looking for these signs. He's convinced that these are all real monsters, that Lovecraft was really writing about things that were really happening, and that his dad was destroyed by the old ones, which are also the system, and that they are also out to get him.
Right.
And that the reasons for why things have gone wrong in his life are because of these old ones.
Okay. Yeah. That's a good way.
So what are some things about Resume with Monsters that you like or dislike or whatever?
Like I said, besides having a character that you can really kind of jump in with and identify with, there's a humor that, the stuff that's disturbing or horrific that occurs is disturbing and horrific.
Yeah.
There's a sense of humor sprinkled throughout the whole thing.
Yeah, yeah.
It's almost to me like whereas I think a lot of people, when they talk about the whole doldrum job and, you know, wanting to rebel against the system, the book that everybody kind of points out is Fight Club.
Right.
I like this better because I think it's a little bit more fantastical.
Well, it is.
And its approach. Yeah. But I still think it kind of, it gives you those feelings,
yes,
of how much this sucks and being part of the system. He really lets you feel it through, like, talking about the way that the character just, like, feels about the building. Like,
yes.
Simple the things like that. The dreariness of those things.
The monotony, like, doing the same thing over and over again. And I saw, like, glimpses or bits of the corporate policies you started to see in the 90s where everybody was expecting you to be loyal to the company without the company actually giving you any sort of loyalty.
Yeah.
You know, like this whole, like, one of the things about Ralph that he does is he always
motivational,
he gives them motivational tracks in their paycheck.
Yeah.
And these motivational tracks, you'll have to read the book to find out more about them. But the fact that he's even putting them in there but he'll go and, like, just fire somebody, like, right off the bat. So he's, like, wanting all this good stuff, and he's wondering why morale is so low at his company. And it's not because of these tracks that you're putting in there. It's because you're a terrible boss.
Yeah.
And you've created this terrible system around just firing people and all this sort of stuff, and yet you're wanting, like, hard work and loyalty and efficiency from your people. Like, it's a complete disconnect between the corporate jargon that they want to throw out in the actual system that they've created.
Yeah, and it's even funnier to watch it because I think it's the idea that it's not a huge company that he's working for either.
Not at that point, no.
Yeah, so it's very interesting to see that aspect of it too. Like, here's a smaller business trying to apply those things.
Yeah, that thinking that
oh, well, these corporate you know, things work, so maybe I should apply them to my small little resume business.
Yeah.
And they don't work.
No.
Because you're a terrible boss.
Well, and they really don't work overall, but there's that sense of, like, the way that the corporate system attempts to basically suck all of the personality and life from you. There's kind of a Stepford Wives almost sort of thing in later on. And that's not really that big a deal. You'll figure that out later. But it's just kind of like, again, this idea that the corporate system just takes the individuality away from people. And this is something that's really, like, personal to me, because I've gotten to this point in my career where I've seen that happening to people. I've seen the way that, and I work in education, I'm a teacher, and there is this attempt at standardization that's been going on for, like, the last 16 years, pretty much my entire career.
Yeah.
Where they're trying to get everybody to do the same thing, and they've even had school districts that have said, okay, we're going to make all the lesson plans for you, and all you have to do is deliver them. There's this kind of, like, attempt to take away professionalism from people, to take away all the creativity and the artistry that happens in teaching, and try and boil everything down to numbers and put everything in charts and do all this data tracking. Like, when they're doing the data tracking,
yeah,
which is, again, it's not a spoiler, it's data tracking, it's a corporation, and they're kind of in colored pencils and they have colors for everything. I've literally done that in a spreadsheet in Excel for students, and I thought about that and I was like, oh my gosh, it's totally there.
I was knee deep. I've been in retail, like, pretty much my whole professional career, and that's retail. I think with in the retail environment, the thing that always made me laugh is we always do things in they love to do what are they called? Getting we have the you have a phrase and the phrase says a word.
Oh, acronyms.
Yes.
That's or acrostic know. Poems or
it's acronyms. It's so they love like so every and this goes for every retail company I've ever worked for. They mm-hmm. love acronyms.
Yes.
And the argument well. They say is that it makes it easy to remember. No, it doesn't.
No,
it doesn't make it easy to remember at all.
No.
And in fact, the thing that you the acronym that you're using when you actually sound it out for the thing that it says actually makes no sense in the first place.
Yeah,
y'all just came up with this because that's you, that's the word I've always felt like in the retailer. That's the word you wanted to use. So you made it fit.
Mm-hmm.
Like I saw one that had to do with like cold temperatures, like our processing, and one of the food site areas, and it, the acronym for the process was COOL.
Oh, awesome!
That's just to great. Give you a. It's funny because there's not actually no creativity with them whatsoever.
Oh yeah, no.
So
well, like we have in Texas, we have the back in the when I first started teaching, we had the TOSS. Test, so they called it TAS. It was TAAS, Texas Assessment of Academic Skills, and then they changed that to TAX, and so then you had the Texas Assessment of Knowledge and Skills, and then you had the what was it? We had the TEX, or some people say it the way they pronounce it usually is the TEKS, but it's TEKS, and that should totally be TEX, and that's a whole other thing. But that's the Texas Essential Knowledge and Skills, and then you have the STAR test, which is the State of Texas Assessment of Academic Readiness, and then you have ARDS that you go to, which is in what does it even stand for? I've gotten forgotten. I don't remember anymore. But you have that, and then you have IEPs on kids, and you have 504 plans, and you have just all of this alphabet soup of stuff that if you like listen to a teacher meeting, and I'm sure this is true of corporations where you go and you hear people just talking, you have no idea what anybody's saying.
Yeah.
Like you can't interpret it at all.
I have a particular manager, and I'm not worried about saying this because he's never going to listen to this. I have a particular manager who likes to do that. He likes to talk in corporate speak at me. He's the only one who does it. And I always want to look at him and be like, you know, if you want to get on my nerves more than anything, it's corporate. Corporate speak is the one way to, or management talk. Mm-hmm. Is the one way to really kind of like drive me pretty bonkers, and all that comes down to is that it really allows you to identify with the feeling that Philip's having throughout the whole story. And he plays it off so well, but it's almost like it's cool because it's like I think it's right there. It's a layer. It's an important layer of the whole story.
Right.
It's like Browning Spencer's critiquing.
Mm-hmm.
Corporate culture.
Yes.
But he's doing it in a very subversive way.
Yeah, yeah. It's like, you know, you have Fight
By making
Club,
it
of course.
A part of the story and also being the idea of like making fun of it almost in a way that there's control from this outside power, you know, kind of thing.
Like the idea of Cthulhu or Yog-Sothoth being in charge of all of this, that Azathoth is like really trying, he really wants to get into like the corporations so that they can control things. It's just like, it so makes sense because if you think about like the way that even, you know, government or corporations, their control of things is like the octopus thing. And you always see like in Lovecraft, these underwater octopusy things just like trying to control everything, but also driving people crazy. That's like that's a fundamental part of like the
core.
I completely understand why it is. And you can see like the same thing in a movie like Office Space as a movie that takes a different tact, a completely comedic tact with it. But, you know, what happens in Office Space could be exactly what's going on if instead of, you know, it just being, what's the name of the boss? Guy. Anyways,
yeah, I don't know.
Gary Cole's character.
Yeah.
If he were not only like that, but then also like he went into his office and tried to resurrect employees with the Necronomicon.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah, I get it.
I mean, it totally fits. You could just take that and run with it. So, like I said, I really like Resume with Monsters. I read through the entire thing this week, and which again I don't usually do with books, but I was like so into it that I just kind of went ahead and just read the entire thing after I read The Return of Count Electric, and just again was just so what I liked about rereading this book. Years since I read it before, you know, it's been, I don't know how long since I read it, is that it still sticks with me. Like rereading it, I was just as into it and just as fascinated by it.
Yeah.
And almost, you know, it gave me a renewed my appreciation. William Browning Spencer is one of those authors that he's always there. I'm always like, oh man, I wish he would put out another book at some point because I love reading his stuff. I wish more people would know about it. But rereading Resume with Monsters all the way through just renewed that for me. Yep. So I just think it's a great book. Everybody should go out. It's relatively short too. It's not stuck. It's
yeah, long. Yeah. And that's the cool thing about all of his books. Actually, they're not long reads.
Yeah, like, these aren't.
Everybody can pretty much figure out really quickly that I did not reread any of these.
Oh,
so
that's right.
I'm going purely based off my memory of the last time I read it, which is probably close to 6 or 7 years ago.
Yeah. Well, that leads us into Zod Wallop, which I haven't finished reading. I did start rereading it, as I mentioned a couple of, well, gosh, I think back in February, I mentioned that I had started rereading it. This one's again out on ebook on Amazon. I mentioned before it's $2.99. There's no reason not to go buy it. It's $3. I mean, seriously, like you're not gonna get more value for your buck than an entire book for $3, and it's an amazing book.
That's true.
So Zod Wallop is about an author named Henry Gainsborough who wrote children's books. But he never saw himself as primarily a children's book author. He wrote books for his daughter.
Right.
And his daughter drowned in an accident, and that threw him into a bout with alcoholism and despair and depression. And he went to a psychiatric hospital named Harwood Psychiatric. And while he was there, he worked on a new book called Zod Wallop. So the book Zod Wallop is inside of the book Zod Wallop. And this book has made a huge impression on some of the inmates, or I say inmates, that sounds terrible. They're not really inmates because it's a low security sort of facility. On some of the patients at Harvard Psychiatric, including Raymond Story.
He'd be the one, I think, the more driving force behind it, yeah.
Yeah.
He's probably, I think, influenced, his love of that book has influenced everybody surrounding him in his little gig.
Yes. And he's such a like dynamic personality that and he's managed to convince these people basically that the world of Zod Wallop is real. That, and not, and this is a funny thing. There's actually like two versions of the Zod Wallop book. The first one was a negative version. It didn't end happily. And then he rewrote it. Harry Gainsborough rewrote it for Raymond, and that's the version that Raymond is attached to. And this book has become hugely successful. They want, you know, there's people from Hollywood who want to make it into a movie. And so Henry Gainsborough is kind of different from Philip Keenan in the sense that Gainsborough is a successful published author.
Yeah.
And the work was not what was a problem for him. The problem for him is the loss of his daughter. In rereading this one, and I'm not finished with it yet, but I love the idea of art as a catharsis.
Yeah.
That it's something that you do you can use the art to get through what you're going through. And that really spoke to me a lot with all the terrible things I've had happen in the last couple of years.
Well, and also the idea too is like not only that art is it's catharsis, but it's also like something that I loved and that I understood to a degree is the idea that you create art for somebody else sometimes. Sometimes you're not concerned with, like you could be telling your child a story,
right?
And that story could be something that ends up being hugely successful, but you didn't write it for anybody else.
Yeah.
You wrote it for them. You know, sometimes that creative process, you know, being a dad now too, especially that always kind of it was always connected with me. It's like you do goofy stuff,
yeah,
to make the kid laugh.
Oh yeah,
and you know, it's not about entertaining anybody else.
Yeah, and I can pretty much do with anything. I can take this back to Tolkien. And that's where The Hobbit came from. The Hobbit was a story that Tolkien told to his kids, and his kids would ask for him to retell it to them over and over again, but they would remember what had happened in the story, and they remembered like random like every detail. And so at one point his oldest son Michael like said something about, "Well, last time you told the story that dwarf's hood was red and now it's green." And Tolkien got so like frustrated with that he's like, "Well, I'm going to write it down and then we'll know exactly what the color of the hood is."
Yeah.
And so he wrote it down. That's where The Hobbit came from. It was the story that he told to his kids.
Right.
And that whole concept that you do tell stories for other people, but then you can also, but art can be cathartic as well. That it doesn't, it kind of, it's both sides of it.
Yeah.
Spencer, you can tell he's saying this is, and I, again, without knowing this, so this is actually like an example of crit fic or, you know, critical fiction where I'm going to invent a fiction here. You get the impression reading all this stuff that these are issues that William Browning Spencer has gone or is going through.
I agree.
They're like the stories, it recurs.
You have no confirmation of that.
Yeah, I don't know that for sure.
You get the impression, like there's an intimate detail that he writes with mm-hmm. that gives you the impression that, it's weird because you always create characters in your head. I've having seen this picture of William Browning Spencer, and he's this little old man now. but you almost imagine the characters as younger versions of him.
Yes.
At least I do when I've read them.
I do.
And that's every single... I don't... It's really strange for the three protagonists of those three main stories. Mm-hmm. I always picture the same person.
Yes. Yeah.
Throughout all of them.
Yeah.
And that's... Which is funny because they're not...
Oh, they're portrayed completely different.
They're completely different characters. They don't act in the similar ways whatsoever.
Yeah, I don't think you could accuse Spencer of writing himself.
Right.
He's not, so it's not like he's not writing, you know, Philip Keenan is not Harry Gainsborough. They're completely different characters. They respond in completely different ways. But the themes of the things that are happening in these stories are so similar. It's that the idea of
you feel a real personal ship from, there's an authorial, like personal
authenticity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You really, really kind of connect with it really easily. You get the impression of somebody who's actually, who knows what they're talking about.
Well, I mean,
you almost get the impression, like you said, it is crit fix, but it's like the idea of write what you know.
Yeah.
And the way that he writes about, especially from the emotional side of these things, very much comes off like an author writing what they know.
Yes. And you can even take it to like one of the specific details that occurs in all three of these novels, Resume with Monsters, Zod Wallop, and Irrational Fears, is the idea of, you know, of psychiatric institutions and going to group therapy and talking with psychologists and psychiatrists. If I were to write a book like that, it would be completely inauthentic. I'd have to do a lot of research to figure it out and to really understand it. Because right now, if I were to write that book, it would be based upon the things that I've seen in William Browning Spencer's books.
Right.
But he's got it there, and I can only assume that must mean he was really good at doing his research, or he's had some sort of interaction with that world.
Yeah.
Because he understands like the way that these things work.
Well, there's a fascination. Yeah, there's a fascination with it. I think in all three of those books, we could go ahead and bring Irrational Fears into this too, because I don't have enough on Irrational Fears. That's the last one that I read, and it still was about 6 years ago that I read.
Yeah.
But yeah, like that's one of those things that it's very much like, and it doesn't all feel the same.
Oh
that,
no,
it's
no, really, no!
It's something that I noticed when I read all three books is like it's a reoccurring theme, but like it doesn't all feel the same.
No,
like the Jack Lowry character in Irrational Fears.
Yeah.
It almost was all three of them in different ways. Like, you know that he was the, you know, like that Harry Gainsborough was there.
Right.
You know that there's a section in Resume with Monsters where Philip's going through that again.
Yes.
And then there's, and then Jack has just recently entered.
Yes.
The program where he's been there for at least a little bit. He's been going in and out, though. That's the one that I think is more focused, too, on an actual, like, to me, the biggest threat about Irrational Fears is alcoholism.
Yeah, if you look at these three books, they don't, while they are dealing with mental illness, they're dealing with different sections of it. Philip Keenan is more in, I mean, Philip Keenan is almost like Raymond's story, not in the literal level. They're not like, they're not the same character at all. They're completely different, but they're almost like schizophrenic. Again, keeping in mind that I'm going to say that I'm not a doctor and do not understand schizophrenia.
There's a detachment from reality.
Yeah. There's a detachment from reality for them. Henry Gainsborough is dealing with depression. Now the depression he medicates with alcohol, but he's not, I don't think, at least in my impression of him, is not specifically an alcoholic.
No.
Whereas Jack Lowry,
alcoholism is like a, it's a symptom. It's not a, it's not the primary.
Yeah,
cause.
He's drinking because things are kind of terrible in his life.
Right.
And then Lowry is an alcoholic, and he's going to an institution that's specifically for alcoholics.
Right.
And this is actually one, when I first read Irrational Fears, I would have said this is the darkest of them. Not having read it in a while, and I still need to go back and read it, I'm not sure that I agree with that anymore, because in starting Zod Wallop, I was getting like, I mean, just really like, I'm feeling a lot of the pain in Zod Wallop more than I did when I first read it.
Yeah.
And that's partly because of things that have happened.
I would go so far to say I agree with with you on the first statement. I do think Irrational Fears is the darkest of these books.
Right, so. And I think that it probably is. But Zod Wallop in my head, I would have said, oh, you could totally, you know, give Zod Wallop to somebody who hasn't read William Browning Spencer, and this will be the entry book. And I still think that.
That would be the preferred. Yeah, I agree with you.
I still think you should read Zod Wallop.
Zod Wallop is the one you should start off with.
Yeah, but at the same time, I don't want to say, I think it's darker in a lot of aspects than Resume with Monsters is.
Well, I think the greatest thing that he does that, and this is something to keep in mind, darkness aside, is that there is like this natural humor throughout all three books.
Yeah.
Things occur that will make you kind of like, they'll kind of make you grin or chuckle.
Oh, I chuckle all the time.
A character says something that you're like, oh, that's kind of funny. You know, good retort things that you hear that character say. And that's something that's very endearing about the way he writes too, is that you never, if things were dreary the whole way through, you wouldn't want to read it.
Oh yeah.
And he's very good at balancing that idea of, I'm talking to you about a dreary subject.
Yes.
But I'm not going to make the whole book just this slog to try to read through.
Oh, yeah. To give you an example, you've got in Zod Wallop, in the first chapter or so, you're hearing about the backstory, and you're finding out about, you know, Harry and what he's gone through and the loss of his daughter, and it's really sad. And then Raymond's story, like, he has like a pet monkey who just like runs around that he liberated from somewhere, and you're just listening to him talk about it. He calls him Lord Arbus. It's like, and he's talking to the monkey, or about the monkey is Lord Arbus, and you're like, that is just, it's just hilarious. It's like,
oh, yeah.
So funny.
He even gives you like the nice little, like, before he kind of brings you into Harry's world, I think it starts off with the wedding.
Yes.
Yeah. So Raymond marries Emily. Emily is Emily?
Yeah, it is Emily. He calls her the Frozen Princess.
The Frozen Princess. Like, and she is, I think, wheelchair bound.
She's wheelchair bound. She doesn't talk. And she's just kind of, she kind of like makes some noises.
Yes.
You know, she's responding to the world. Like,
right.
She's having like when she's, but she can't really move.
Yeah.
And it's a very bizarre sort of thing, but it's from the point of view in that scene from the preacher, the priest, overseeing the wedding. And he's just kind of like, well, that was a thing that happened.
That was a thing that happened.
Oh.
'Cause it was,
and
yeah.
These people just show up and they chase these people through, like the orderlies people show up and they're running around. And
yeah.
He's like, well, that happened.
I remember for a while there, I was trying to get, I think I almost had you convinced, but we were trying to come up with band names.
Yeah.
And we almost thought about going with Lord Draining because that's one of my favorites.
I like it a lot.
So,
you know, we'll have to see how that goes
strange up
again. But I did think of, as an example of one of the things in all these books, but especially in Zod Wallop as I was reading through it, there's these, this impression of greater depth and lots of stuff going on. And it reminded me of something that either C.S. Lewis or J.R.R. Tolkien talked about, when there are times when you have like a title or an idea, like a few words, that inside of the words it completely conjures up a story that, you know, that the story itself would never be as, if you actually told the story or you had it written down, it wouldn't be as powerful as the imagery and the ideas that your imagination creates through hearing those words. And one of those was the phrase, Harry Bottle fights the midnight machine. Like, that phrase, when I heard that, I was like, that sounds epic in the literal epic sense of the word. That is an epic quest. And just reading those words on the page, I don't know that you could ever write that story and have it be as moving as just the impact of the phrase.
Yeah.
If that's something that I can say, it's an amazing, look, that is all the way through it. And there's little snippets of Zod Wallop, the book, in there. And I think that a lot of times people would be they'd be like, well, let's have the book. You know, why doesn't William Browning Spencer just write the book of Zod Wallop?
Because it would never
match your,
yeah, how your, you envision it in your head. Yeah.
It would never work. Same thing with Philip Keenan's book, The Despicable Quest. Like, you he could write that book, but that book would never be as interesting as the book that he actually wrote, which was Resume with Monsters.
Yeah.
And so I just, it's a, Zod Wallop is great.
Hearing them describe, yeah, some of the books that you have, and like, there's enough of an impression that, yeah, it would never live up in your brain.
Yeah. How
that goes. So.
So in, Irrational Fears, we already mentioned the main character, Jack Lowry, who goes into a detox place called Hurley Detox, and he has a counselor, named Wesley Parks, and he gets attached to this woman named Carrie Beckett, who he doesn't know outside of the detox. And most places would tell you, like, it's probably a bad idea to get involved with people when you meet them in a psychiatric facility of some sort.
Yes.
But the,
I guess, like, one of the major rules that they actually try to apply. Like, don't
so you have
attachments outside.
So in Irrational Fears, you have this central idea of alcoholism and the things you're dealing with that, which is kind of interesting. That would be an interesting book just by itself, I suppose. But then you have this cult called The Clear. And they are convinced, and this is, they're convinced that the drunks are the progeny of an ancient alien tribe, and that there's this giant cosmic battle called the Unraveling, and they're trying to, like, basically, like, create an army to go fight in this war.
Right.
And when I read, and I had to go back and read the description of it, because, again, it had been so long since I read it. I don't know about you, but I thought Scientology.
Yeah.
Like a little bit of a criticism of Scientology.
That
there
was kind of my impression. I remember when I read it, because I think, wasn't it, they end up going to, they go to different AA meetings, I guess, because they always end up.
Yeah.
Because they almost end up, I think part of their program is they almost go to a different AA program a night.
Yes. In Jen's home. Hi.
Because I gotta go pee anyway, so I was like, "Oh, good." Okay, cool. And I want to see if I remember correctly, out of just from memory, is it one of the AA programs that isn't run by like a Cult of Cthulhu almost?
Yeah, I actually wrote down one of the phrases in there. There was a phrase that, "But for the grace of Azathoth, you know, like, you know, but for the grace of God, go I."
Yeah.
Kind of idea. There's like a lot of those sorts of things that are in there.
Well, it's always cool, because I think every single AA like meeting that they go to, it's like a different like belief system that they're kind of basing it on. So it's kind of a rad idea. I kind of like the idea of, like, it's kind of cool that Cthulhu kind of shows back up here and just in a very mild way.
A little bit, yeah.
So yeah.
So those are the books that we've read so far. Again, I want to encourage people to take a look at stuff. There's, you know, this is the first time that you can really easily get stuff by William Browning Spencer. There's a couple of magazine short stories. I'll just go ahead and say those so people can know to look for them. In Lightspeed Magazine, the December 2013 issue, he has a story called The Foster Child. And I started reading this one, and I would just say, like, you just have to read this one. This is one of those ones where it's hard to describe what's going on, but he is creating a whole new world, but he's doing it the way that I want people to do it when you create a new world. And that is, you're not just saying, like, you're not giving a whole bunch of exposition. Let me explain how this world works. It's like all in the dialogue, and then it's a first person narrative. So you're having to pay attention to how this person is describing things and the things they're referring to in order to understand that this is not the normal world.
Oh, that's really awesome.
And then the other one that I haven't read yet, but I do went ahead and got it, is in Clark's World Magazine, issue 94. And the title of this I love, because it's called The Halfway House at the Heart of Darkness.
Okay.
So it sounds right, just exactly like I would expect from a William Browning Spencer.
And one of the short stories that I read, that I think I said it earlier, was it's called Penguins of the Apocalypse.
Yes.
It was in the 2008, I think, Best of Sci-Fi Horror anthology that came out that year. I wish I remembered something about it. I don't remember. It's one of those weird, it's got a male protagonist centered story.
Yeah.
I want to say it involves a man who's in his son in some capacity.
Yeah.
That's all I remember. And the Penguins of the Apocalypse is sort of a weird, it has to do with static. I'll say that much.
Okay.
The idea of like static, thinking about the Penguins of the Apocalypse and static and how that stuff works.
Cool.
So, I mean, that's pretty much it.
Yeah. So, I mean, we just want to encourage people to go out and find something.
Yeah.
you know, check it out and see what you think. I have been putting out on Twitter, on our Twitter account, these little memes of stuff from there. I'm going to keep doing that just because I think it's really funny. And
he's got some great stuff that you just take snippets of. Yeah. He's that author that there are authors who are popular who don't deserve to be popular.
Yeah.
Stephanie Meyer.
Right.
And this guy's just been like living in obscurity in Austin. Maybe he likes that. I don't know.
It could be. I'm not.
He might not
that.
Care as much about being a huge author. He just likes to write, which I think shines through in his work.
Right.
He's not interested in trying to. He's not writing things to please the audience per se.
Yes.
He is.
But he writes. This is a key point. He's obviously writing things that whatever he wants to write. He's writing that. And
but he's not writing for like a big audience.
He's not writing for a mainstream audience, but he is writing for an audience.
Yeah.
He writes entertaining stories.
He writes for the reader.
And he writes for the reader, yeah.
Yeah.
And so the person who will read that story is the person that should read it. And I would encourage anybody from our audience, I would think that this would be, if Neil Gaiman is something you're into, or Terry Gilliam, I was just thinking about this the other day, that I think that if a director, and this is why I told people to listen to the Terry Gilliam episode ahead of this one, if there were going to be a director to make a Zod Wallop or a Resident Evil Monsters movie, I would want it to be Terry Gilliam, I think. What he does is the same thing you see going on in Neil Gaiman and in Terry Gilliam, is this connection of the real world with this fantastical world, and the way that those two intersect and interplay off of each other. Those three creators are really, that's a big part of their work, and I just think it's amazing. So
yeah, that's awesome. That's all right.
So
all right, so you guys can find us every day on the good old Facebook. We are at Watch, Read, Listen Podcast.
Yeah, on Twitter, we're WRL Podcast.
And every day at watchreadlisten.net when we decide to post stuff on there. So we're not there every day.
Yeah, we need to get
every
better at that.
I got a couple ideas for articles. I have, like I said, I've been trying to make sure not to say anything unless I actually get stuff, until I get a grind.
Right.
Putting stuff out. Got a couple ideas for stuff that I haven't solidified. I think I wrote a very long, rambly thing that I think it is worth.
I found it interesting.
It's worth reading, if only because it shows that if you don't watch out, you go down a really, really weird, long thread of the internet.
Yeah.
It can be dangerous sometimes. We are going to be, we're giving you guys a twofer this week. So if you listen to this, go listen to our Batman v Superman one as well. So we're going to drop two of those for you this week.
We also want to encourage people again on iTunes. Rate us and review us. I'm going to go ahead and just lay it out there that the reason, not the only reason, but there's two reasons why I want people to rate us and review us on iTunes. The first one is that iTunes is still where people find most of their podcasts. They don't really seem to find them on Facebook and on Twitter very much. iTunes is where it's at, and the more traction we get on iTunes, the better it works. So even if you don't use iTunes on a regular basis, if you have it on your computer, fire it up, open up the podcast thing, search for us, rate us and review us, and it'll help us out. And the other thing is that if we get enough reviews and we're good enough, and we get some written reviews too, then we can start doing Audible sponsorship thing, where if we get people to sign up for Audible, they'll give us a little bit of money, and that'll help us out. Also, I've been posting in the show notes the links to various things that you can buy on Amazon, and that's through my affiliate link, and that'll help out the podcast as well.
Yeah.
So, you know,
do what you can.
The Amazon is cool because it doesn't cost you anything.
Yeah.
At this point, we're not asking for anybody's money or anything like that. This isn't something that's costing us a ton of money or anything like that, but we would like to kind of start covering some of the costs.
It'd be cool if we could expand it at some point too.
Like
we could do a little bit more.
Yeah.
Right now, it's just what the available equipment we have.
Yeah.
And which is good enough.
And the bandwidth, you know, the amount of podcast we can put out a month is limited by how much we pay. So anyways, so anything, you know, if you can help us out in any way with that, that'd be awesome.
So, all right, guys, we'll see you guys on the next show.
Bye.
Thank you for listening. Fuck.
Read.
Revisited. I did it.
Yay.